We're glad all of you are here. We're going to have a baptism this morning. I'm not just up here standing in the water. Thought I would go ahead and point that out. If you are new and we'd ask that you'd fill out a connect card, please for us, that is in the seat in front of you there, in the back of the seat in front of you. Also, we have a member of our church that's got a medical need that we need to help them with in benevolence. So if you would, if you're able to do that, then today you could put that in the offering. We would really appreciate that. Also, our Thanksgiving dinner is coming up 2 weeks from today. That'll be at 4:00. You should have received a card. Everybody receive a card when they came in? If you'll fill that out, if you're interested in coming and who's coming with you, and we'll get a count for that so we can turn that in. We always have a good time. That was so fun last year. We had a big time. We had a bunch of people here, and we all got to have Thanksgiving dinner, and we even brought in some jelly cranberry sauce for Frank. So it's amazing. We have this gourmet food, and the preferred cranberry is the one that still has the rings on it because it just came out of the can. I mean, it's hilarious. So, also, the Tuesday after that, we'll be decorating the sanctuary and the parlor and the foyer and the fellowship hall and anything else we can think of for Christmas, because we love Christmas. Sorry. We love Christmas, so we love celebrating that. The last announcement I have is this coming Saturday from 10 to 12, Santa will be here. Y'all didn't know that, but we have a personal connection with Santa. That is actually my granddaughter sitting on Santa's lap, and that is actually her great-grandfather and great-grandmother. Legit. For those of you that didn't know. So we do have a personal connection with Santa. Would love for you to come be a part of that. The date is wrong. It is this coming Saturday. That is not the correct date. The correct date is the 12th. Yeah, today is the 7th, right? So Saturday, we will have some breakfast there too, continental breakfast, donuts and coffee, and we have people signed up to serve and to take care of the registration and stuff, but we have over 300 people that have said they're either coming or interested in coming to that. I'm not going to be here. My wife's out of town doing a worship at a conference for 3 days. I've got a basketball game that I've got to leave at 10 o'clock to go to in Illinois. So I need 15 or 20 people extra than what we've talked about to come and just work the crowd, just be there talking to people, make sure everybody's good. And I would really, really appreciate that if you would help us out on that day. Amen. Good? How many of you would help us out on that day? Say amen. Amen. Good. You've got several hands raised. Good. Thank you so much. Stand up on the confession of your faith and obedience to the word of God. I now baptize you in the name of Jesus. Everybody say, in Jesus' name. Amen. There we go.
Amen. Will you stand with us this morning as we celebrate today?
I'm ready for a miracle. Heart's praying for for a fresh encounter. Souls looking to the living God. I'm ready for a revival. Oh, Holy Spirit, come like a flood, like a fire. Holy Spirit, fall in this place, fill our hearts. Holy Spirit, come like a flood, like a fire. Holy Spirit, oh, oh, Holy Spirit, come.
Can you clap along with us? Help us out.
On the edge of a new beginning, God, we know you have so much more. We're looking to a new horizon. We're praying for your rain to pour, overflowing of true redemption and overflowing of your kingdom, Lord. We're ready for a real revival. Oh, Holy Spirit, come like a flood.
As we just sung about asking the Holy Spirit to come this morning. Come like in our hearts. Let me just ask you something. I don't want you to lift your hand if you don't mean it. How many this morning would like to simply see the Lord, hear the Lord, experience the Lord in a new way, a greater way? That revival would fall upon your life and fall upon your house. Anybody else want that this morning? Anybody else want revival this morning? Want revival like we used to have? Remember those days? Well, we could have it every than a Sunday. Let's sing this.
Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the flood. Of heaven, let it rain, let it victory. Open the floodgates of heaven.
Let's sing that again as a prayer.
Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. We feel the rain of your love. We feel the wind of your spirit. And the heartbeat of heaven, let us hear. We feel the rain of your love. We feel the wind of your spirit. Heartbeat of heaven, let us hear.
Stillness of this sacred moment. Many have lifted their hands this morning that they want to draw closer to you. They want to encounter you in a new and a fresh way. They pray for revival, for a new season of walking closer with you. Let it happen, God. Let it rain. And Father, right now, as we have opportunity just to give, just a small portion of all we have from you, we say we love you. We want to trust you and obey you, Lord. Take this money and multiply it and use it for your glory. And everybody said, you can be seated.
Oh, your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet, caught up in this holy moment. I never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings, 'cause Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. And I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. And I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence, and I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment.
This morning, just to fill us, to anoint us, to rest on us. So I want to do something else this morning as you're standing and worshiping and seeking Him. If you're in need of a special prayer, I know our pastor would love to come. We'd love for you to come and Him just pray with you. This is not the invitation. Just say, I need something extra from God this morning. Or if you just want to come to this altar and fall on your knees and just worship Him. It's time for us to move to the next level of our worship of the Lord. We don't have to be afraid. God is safe. So let's worship. Let's seek Him like we already said we wanted to afresh this morning. To remain as you lead us, please.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God.
Who else would come this morning? Say, God, I want more of you.
On me.
I don't want to play. I want you fresh. I want revival.
Break me, melt me, mold me, fill me, Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me.
Sing Spirit of the Living God one more time, please.
Spirit,
Pastor, it's yours.
The Living God, fall fresh on me. Break me, melt.
beautiful presence of the Lord in this place. What do you do when you've prayed and you've cried for years asking Him to come? And then He comes. Do you stop and host Him, or you just keep going with your agenda? Ever since Data and I've been doing this for 29 years, we've said, here's our list, here's our schedule, our outline of our service until Holy Spirit interrupts. This is what we're going to be doing when you get here. Here it is. And then once He gets here, we throw it out the window. You do what you want, Jesus. Okay? So what happens when He shows up? Do we do what's next? Or do we wait and do what He wants? You see, Frank kind of tricked y'all. He prayed a prayer and said, just Holy Spirit, have your way. His way isn't always in our outline. Oh, we want to think it is. We want to, you know, we're trying. We're doing our best. So what I want us to do right now is I want you, if you would please, just bow your heads. I want you to join hands with somebody near you. And we're going to thank Him. Father, I just thank You right now for Your presence in this room. Every heart, thank You for those that already responded to Your presence and came down front. Thank You for every heart in this room, Lord, that You are touching, that You are ministering to, God, because that is exactly what You're doing, and we know that. We want You to know that we're listening. We want You to know we're here. We want to follow You. Whatever You want to do, we say we'll follow You. In Jesus' name, everybody say amen. Amen. God bless you. You can be seated for just a minute. Thank you so much, worship team. Thank you, Frank, for following the Holy Spirit. We do have a one order of business I want to take care of. So, yes, Super Church. Kids, y'all can go. Thank you. Sorry about that. I was about to preach. I do have one order of business I want to take care of right now, and I'm so honored to be able to do this morning. If you are a veteran, would you please stand? If you are a veteran, would you please stand? All our veterans, please stand. Thursday is Veterans Day, and we want you guys, gals, I thought there was a gal around, we want you guys to know how much we love you, how much we honor you. Thank you so much for what you did, what you are doing for us, for our country. Thank you for your service. Everyone, please give them a hand, would you? Thank you. You can all be seated. Thank you. Amen. We love you. We don't do that enough, but one or two times a year there, I think we ought to do it. During that Veterans Day and then is it Memorial Day, I guess, is the other one. Amen. Someone said this, and it sounds very hard, but please hear the spirit behind it. On Memorial Day, you know, we honor those that gave their life for our country, but and the statement was this, please hear the whole statement. No one won a war by giving their life for the country. Someone had to be alive to win the war. Okay, now, again, I'm not belittling. I don't mean that. You understand? Hear the whole thing. Someone had to stay around. Some of you probably lost guys in the war, friends in the war, and we honor them and don't take anything from that, but somebody had to come home. And we're so glad that you all are able to serve and come home. Amen? Yeah. Third week of I'm In. Excited about this, and I'm going to try to roll through this. Brooklyn, you got some help for me on this one? So we're going to talk about I'm an influencer. You got a TikTok? No? Okay. So there, some of you are familiar with social media, and some of you are not as much, but they have these new things on there that they keep coming up with new things. They came up with Instagram, and they got Snapchat, and they got TikTok now, and people are becoming influencers with TikTok. The top TikTok person in the world has 151 million subscribers, followers. So understand something. He has people that want to advertise on his TikToks because he has so many people that he can reach with those TikToks, right? So he is what is called an influencer. Look at your neighbor, say influencer. So now, understanding number one in the world is 151 million followers. How many of you are influencers? Absolutely. We all should have raised our hand, and some of you saw through the trickery of the preacher. Sometimes we kind of get embarrassed. We feel like, well, man, I guess I'm not an influencer. I've got a pastor's wife, but the two of them are great friends of ours. He was my roommate in Bible school, and she wants with all her heart to be an influencer. She will tell you, I want to follow me, I want to be an influencer. And Dana's not even trying, and Dana has twice as many followers as she does. And Dana don't want to be an influencer. It's like, well, sometimes it takes more than having the want to, huh? So, first week I preached on I'm invited. Last week I preached on I'm invaluable. Today we're going to talk about I'm influential. With all my heart, I believe that everyone in this room, that all of us are called to be influencers. You have no idea how one idea, one conversation, one word of encouragement, one expression of love might change someone's life. Some of you didn't raise your hand because I purposely hijacked the word influencer and tainted the way you were defining that word. In society, they define the word influencer as an individual who has the power to affect purchase decisions of others because of their authority, knowledge, or relationship with their audience. A teacher, a coach, a celebrity, a thought leader, a content creator. They find their niche. They most of the time find something unique, and they pick their channel or their hashtags, and they do it just right. And they've just destroyed the actual definition of the word influencer. Today, I am leading a charge starting at Lewis Lane in Owensboro, Kentucky. It's going to go worldwide. We're going to change back the definition of the word influencer. Here we go. You just remember where you were when it happened, okay? So in Matthew 5:13, the scripture says that you are the salt of the earth. Go to 14. You are the light of the world. Like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden. Neither do people light. No one lights a lamp and then puts it under a basket. Instead, a lamp is placed on a stand where it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. In the same way, let your good deeds influence others. shift how we think about influence. The problem with the current view of influence is this. The current view of influence starts with platform. But the true and lasting influence always starts with people before platform. Influencers on social media pick their platform and people gather. Influencers in real life find their people and see what they need. Let me tell you just a story or two here of personal influence in my life. I was sitting in the choir loft at our church, the church I was raised in, and I don't know if you know this or not, but I played trumpet all my younger days. And so at church, I was playing trumpet in church, and it was pretty amazing. And so we had a revival that week, or for a couple weeks, whatever. And I remember after service, though, during the invitation, and of course we did things there just a little bit differently. And I know that surprises some of you, but we were just a time of lingering and in the altar. And I'm sitting in the choir loft, just sitting in the chair the pew that I was sitting in, and I was just sitting there and just talking to the Lord, or just resting in His presence, or just whatever, you know, just there. And all of a sudden, the evangelist comes by and sits down by me, and he starts talking to me. And understand, my brother's always been bigger, taller, stronger, faster than me. He's never been more good looking than me. But some people got it, and some people don't. So anyway, my brother was second team All American, NAIA basketball player his senior year in college. I went to Bible school. My brother won all the punt, pass, and kicks contests, and I got to go with him. So he was just bigger, and it just would, you would think if Jesse, where are your sons? I'm going to pick one to be king. They would have chosen him. But this preacher looks at me and he said, "Ben, I want you to know something. I'm going to tell you something. I really feel impressed to tell you this." He said, "When it comes to the spirit world, when it comes to the spiritual, when it comes to the church, when it comes to whatever, you will do far more than your brother will ever do. And I want you to know that. I want you to run after that. God's got great things for you." And I don't know where he came up with that. I don't know how he came up with that. But that has stuck with me now for 35 years. That whenever something happens, I got a big brother that's pretty talented, but Jesus likes me better. Wait, that's not what he said. That's not exactly what he said, but. And then also, let me tell you this. I was at Bible school, and so I was young. I graduated high school at 17 because I had a late birthday in October. And I went to Bible school. It was a 3-year school. It was mostly more like postgraduate stuff. We didn't do math and English and stuff. We just did Bible stuff. And so I graduated with a bachelor's of theology. But my third year, which was my senior year, I went back, and I was 20 years. I was 19 years old starting my senior year, and turned 20 in October, and then graduated at 20 years old from Bible college. And I walked in first day. Of course, I was the leading scorer on the basketball team until my brother decided to transfer in. But I'm okay with it now. I was kind of popular, you know. And so first day of lunch, there was probably 20 people at my table, and I'm sitting in the middle. And about a month later, I had managed to dwindle that down to one person. And he had a bum leg, so he couldn't leave. No, I'm just kidding. That's not true. But I was influencing some people. I influenced them to move tables. They called me Papaw because I didn't have time for any of their junk. I know you all cannot imagine that being anything like what I would do. I was kind of serious back then. I have lightened up. I told you, there's already a crown waiting on her, buddy. So every man looks at his potential wife and says, "I don't want her to change a bit." A woman looks over at the man and says, "I can make something out of that one." She saw it. I didn't. She was. You see, influence isn't always instant. Influence isn't always obvious. Just because you don't see the harvest doesn't mean the seed hasn't taken root. You see, we're working on people. God's working on people. We're working on people. Sent a text this morning. Thank you. We're working on people. We're working on people. We're getting people. We're working on people. And God, you think it's something's not happening, but it is happening. Just because you don't see it doesn't mean that it's not happening, that God's not doing something. You have no idea. I'm going to say this a couple more times. You have no idea how one conversation, one word of encouragement, one expression of love might change someone's life. I'm going to hurt some of your heads right now, and I'm just going to do it on purpose. Okay, here we go. I have a friend whose daddy was a missionary to Africa for all his life, 40 years. And he had a tribe, a city, the village he was going to go out to, and he walked there 15, 20, 30 minutes. I don't know how long the walk was, but as he got close to the village, this man jumped out from behind the village. He was naked. He had a dog collar around his neck and a chain, logging chain going back to something that was anchored, and he started growling and yelling and barking and trying to get to this missionary. And as he obviously it scared him because he came around the corner, and he just looked at him and said, "Jesus loves you." Went to the village, did his thing, left. The next day, he's coming out through there, coming back to the village, and the guy runs around the corner again, snarling and screaming and doing his thing at him. He goes, "Jesus loves you." Kept walking. Obviously, the man was, he was afflicted. He had a legion. He had some help, okay? So he told him, "Jesus loved you," and he kept going. The next day, he did this for 7 days. Only thing he spoke to this man was, "Jesus loves you." The seventh day, he comes up, but by now, he's figured out which house it is, and he's no longer surprised because he's looking for him away, long away. He was getting closer, and the guy hadn't come out. By now, he would have already come out, and he is walking and getting closer and getting closer and getting closer. And he comes up, and the man is sitting there. He looks up at him, still chained up, looks up at him, and he said, "Missionary, tell me about this Jesus, because he just set me free." You never know what you're doing. One word of encouragement, one story, one kind pat on the back. Some customer that needs you. You never know what one student, one teacher that you can give a kind word to, maybe when you're struggling, but you can give them a... Never forget this, was raised up with her. The girl won Miss Kentucky out of our school, and she was my girlfriend in the first grade. By high school, she wasn't anymore because she had found football. All right, whatever. And so, but I remember my sophomore year of high school, my buddy Rodney and I, Rodney pastored a Baptist church down in Calvert City, somewhere down there now, and he and I were sitting in chorus class, and we were sitting on the stage, on the edge of the stage, and this girl walked up to us, and she said, "Hey, I need to ask you," and she actually asked me, she said, "Ben, would you pray for my mom? My mom's got breast cancer, and they're not giving her much time. We really need prayer." And of course, I prayed for her right there, and we prayed for her, and my thought, it crossed my mind, and I didn't let it linger long, but I was like, "Where's your football player now?" Understand something. Just because you don't see the influence doesn't mean it's not there. Because it's amazing what happens in time of need of where they turn. And what's fun about this, my scripture for the day is I'm going to go to the Samaritan woman at the well. The woman who no one would have thought would ever have influence. So let me give you quickly context for this story. Jesus was on a trip and he passed through Samaria. Most of the time the Jews would walk around Samaria because Samaria was the place of the half-breeds. They were half Jew, half not. And so the Jews would have rather them just simply been all Gentiles or all Jews. They felt like the ones that were half were less than even humans. They were less than dogs. They did not have any honor, any respect for them at all. And so Jews would most of the time would walk around, and certainly a priest or a rabbi would walk around there because he would not allow himself to get dirty with the Samaritan stuff. Okay? So he is walking through Samaria instead of around, and he sat down at a well. Understanding, a well is the place of gathering because everybody has to have water. Most of the people would come there in the early morning and in the late evening when it was at dark, when it was cooler. So he's there in the middle of the day sitting at a well, and a woman walks up. Why would she come to a well in the middle of the hottest part of the day? Why would she come then? It's very easy. She would come then because there was no one else there. And she was ashamed. And she was being ridiculed. And people were making fun of her. So this Samaritan woman comes to draw water. The woman, and Jesus looks at her and says, "Give me a drink." And the woman was surprised, for Jews refused to have anything to do with Samaritans. She said to Jesus, "You're a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. Why are you asking me a drink?" And Jesus replied, "If you only knew." Jesus never answers the question you ask. Have you noticed that? If you talk to Jesus much, he's not going to answer the question you ask because that's not the right question. Remember? He said, "You have not because you ask not, or because you ask the wrong question." So he's got such grace in it, he helps us ask the right question. He said, "If only you knew the gift that God has for you and who you're speaking to, you would ask me and I would give you living water." She said, but she missed it. Like me. She missed it. But you don't even have a bucket and the well's deep. What you going to do? You going to hit me over the head and steal my bucket? I mean, how are you going to give me living water? Jesus said, "If anyone drinks this water, they will soon become thirsty again. But those who drink the water that I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life." I propose to you, let's sit on that verse for just a second, babe. I propose to you that I think it would be pretty cool if we would let that bubbling water flow out of us. It would clean out some real bad situations in our home and our job and our schools and our government. Almost said government right there. So we need to let the Christians of America, the Christians of the world, need to let that bubbling water flow out of them because it will become a river, and river just doesn't care. Right? It'll just take anything out in its path, clean it out, and get a flow of fresh water going. So she's like, "Please give me that living water. I want that living water. I want that will change and I don't ever have to thirst again." So he looks at her and he says, "Go get your husband." There he goes again. Trick questions. "But I don't have a husband." And he said, "You're right. You don't have a husband. But you have had five husbands, and you're not even married to the man you're living with now. You certainly spoke the truth when you said, 'I don't have a husband.'" Then she looked at him. Now watch this. She's finally catching up. Sir, I've used all the powers of deduction that I have, and my spidey senses are telling me you are a prophet. How long did that take? She was an immoral woman. Therefore, she was a miracle waiting to happen. Haven't preached on this in a, I don't know if I've ever preached on this here, but the scripture says that the man found the treasure buried in a field. The problem is the church misconstrues that scripture and thinks that the field is the building of the church, is the people of the church, that the treasure is buried inside the pews. The treasure's out there. Out there are miracles waiting to happen. Every time you see somebody, every time you speak to somebody, every time you meet somebody, it's a miracle that Jesus is wanting to do in their life. Set them free. Give them eternal life. He wants that river to flow out of them. She was thirsty. Maybe that it relates to craving attention, or maybe it was daddy issues, or she was in the wrong crowd, or it was abusive, or this cycle of dysfunction in her life. And it explains why she did not come early in the morning. She came in the middle of the day. She just didn't want to draw any attention. But it finally starts to dawn on her, you know what? I've heard that there was a Savior coming. My papa's a Jew, and he told me that there was a Savior coming. He talked about miracles, and he talked about this love that this man had, and it just changed his life. And why would a Jewish man offer me living water? So the woman let down her water jar beside the well and ran back to the village, telling everyone. You see, she was an influencer. Okay, I'm just going to say it. All the men knew her. Many of the men knew her. Okay, you didn't like that one either. Enough men knew her that it gave her a living. She was around. They knew. And all of a sudden, she told everyone and said, come and see a man who told me everything I did. Now, I've been in services like that when there was a prophet in the room, and I repented real good before I went. No, you didn't even hear me. I repented real good because I said, Jesus, don't let him tell me, don't tell him all that stuff I've been doing. I don't want that said in the microphone, Jesus, please. Please don't tell him. I didn't mean to steal that bubble gum or any of the other things I did. Come see this man who told me everything I did. Could he possibly be the Messiah? So the people, everybody, came streaming from the village to see him. Some of you think they pulled out their cell phones and they were streaming the account. You didn't know it was in there, did you? Messed up, hurting, broken, immoral woman. You don't have to have your life together to influence someone for Christ. Look at your neighbor and say, you got hope. Now laugh and say, I'm just kidding. You don't have hope. No, it's okay. Wait. I needed to make you laugh. You don't have to have your life all together to influence people for Jesus. Quit trying to get it all figured out. Just do what you're told to do. Woman witnessing. Disciples showed up. They brought food. You see, the fields are ripe for harvest. They realized the fields were ripe. There it was. But the laborers or the influencers are few. Let me draw this to a conclusion real quickly. Many Samaritans from the village believed in Jesus because the woman had said, verse 39, "He told me everything I ever did." Verse 40, "When they came out to see him, they begged him to stay in their village. So he stayed for 2 days, long enough for many more to hear his message and believe." Who did Jesus use? Did he use an Instagram celebrity? Did he use a Hollywood star? No. He used a woman that didn't have it all figured out, had some real serious issues in her life, to change a whole town. You see, he used a woman whose name we don't even know. He spent a whole book in the Old Testament saying names we don't want to read. And he didn't even record this woman's name. She was searching for love in all the wrong places. Ain't nobody going to help me today. Okay. You don't have to have your life all together to influence someone for Jesus. Parents, you have influence. If you haven't figured this out yet, let me be the first one to tell you. You have influence. The most influence that is in your child's life is you. So this is my line that I've said for 20 years. Why don't you bring your kids to Sunday school? Well, you know, I can't get them out of bed. It's 10 a.m. But you'll put them on a bus at 6:30 on Monday. I try to be as nice as I can be, and I'm saying this nice, but I promise you I'm saying this with love too. I want you to know something. What you're really saying is you're telling your child it's okay for you to go to hell, but you will have an education when you get there. They can get out of bed, turn the PlayStation off about 10 o'clock the night before. Unplug it, put it in your room. You're the influence. I wish it wasn't 10:58. I'd preach a little while. Turn off the music that you've been playing and turn on gospel music. Turn on worship music. Change the station in your car till your kids learn the songs we sing on Sunday from the radio. Ooh, he done did that. We don't sing Garth Brooks, sorry. And we don't sing a lot of others too. Invite somebody to church. Text somebody a Bible verse. Post a sermon clip on Instagram. My pastor's on fire this morning. Give something to someone that's in need. You have influence. You are spending your influence. Make sure you spend it where you should. You have no idea how much one conversation, one word of encouragement, one expression of love might change someone's life. Let's stand, would you please? Amen. Would you bow your heads with me? You have no idea how much one conversation, one word of encouragement, one expression of love might change someone's life. Father, today we just are so humbled by your presence that's in this room. Such a wonderful presence for worship and even for the preaching, Lord. I just thank you so much for it. We don't take it lightly. We don't take it for granted. But I do say I want more. We want it again. And Lord, as you moved in this room this morning and started altering the things we were doing, using your influence, I'm asking that you would touch every person in this room every person that's watching online, whether today or in the future, that you would heighten their awareness of the influence they have, that they are giving out, that they're touching, that they're working, that they're giving to someone every single day that influence. I pray that you would give direction. I pray you would give divine appointments. Let us have divine interruptions throughout the week of an opportunity that we have that we can be an influence to someone for you. Whoa, who are you? You look so different. Yeah, let me tell you what Jesus has done in my life. Let me tell you how Jesus has changed my life. And he could do the same for you. Using that influence for the kingdom of God. If you're in this room this morning, you've never given your heart to the Lord, never given your heart to him for you to be saved, today is your day. This is the day. Now is the day of salvation. And I want to pray with you. If you've never done that, would you just lift your hand? We're going to take care of it today. We're going to check it off the list. We'll get that part taken care of because you got influence and you need to use it for the kingdom of God. Anyone? All right. All right. Now, the rest of us. You'd say, Pastor Ben, I want to use my influence for the kingdom of God. Every opportunity I get, I want to use my influence. Would you just lift your hand up? Thank you. That was as generic as I can get. You didn't raise your hand. I don't know how to get you. But I want to pray with every person that raised their hand right now. Father, I thank you that they want to use their influence for the kingdom of God. I pray that you would touch every single life. Lord, crank up the realization, the awareness when we have these opportunities, I pray, that the Holy Spirit that's living inside of us would nudge us and would encourage us and push us to say that word, to give that encouragement, that one encouraging word, that pat on the back, that opportunity that you put in front of us. I pray that you just give us the boldness to act as your Spirit is engaging us and pushing us to and giving us opportunities. I pray you just do that now in Jesus' name. Yeah. That's so cool. Man, if we can figure out our influence, folks, if we can really understand how much influence we have, this place won't be able to hold it. This place won't be able to hold it. So sitting right there, I'm going to ask you to do one thing for me this week. I don't give you much homework. I just want you to read the first 63 books in the Bible. Nope, just kidding. I'm not going to do that. I want you to do this. I want you to find someone this week to invite to come to church with you next Sunday. Whether they're saved, unsaved, if they're saved, going to someplace else. I'm trying to find people that need God, okay? Find somebody, encourage them, ask them to come. Use your influence. The scripture says, the one that winneth souls is wise. So it may not be you need to say, hey, come to church with me. It may mean you might just say, is there something I can pray with you for about? So ask Holy Spirit, hey, Holy Spirit, how do I need to talk to this person? How do I need to minister to this person? What does this person need from you today? Be that for that person. Be salt. Be light. Be leaven. Yeah. Amen. Everybody say amen. Amen. Hannah coming out. Come here. Baptized Hannah today, and it's a thrill of mine every time we get an opportunity to baptize somebody. And so what I want to do is I want y'all to, if you would, in our closing song, y'all can come down front if you would please, and greet her, love on her, and let her know how excited you are that she's made these such big important steps in her life and what God's doing, and be that word of encouragement. Amen. This will be a safe place for you to use that influence right now. Do you want to pray first, Frank? Does everybody need a prayer? Do we need a prayer to leave? Can we not go home if we don't pray? Is that one of the rules?
Well, mine would be long too, you know.
Bro, I'm here. I'm good. Whatever you need to do.
Amen. God is good, isn't he? Amen. And as we leave this place, I want to encourage you to hear what our pastor said. That you would become his hands and feet, his hugs, his smiles, and lead somebody to Jesus. We're going to sing out, "Let It Rain," all right?
Gates of heaven, let it rain, let it rain. Open the flood gates of heaven. We feel the rain of your love, we feel the wind of your spirit. Heartbeat of heaven, let us hear. We feel the rain of your love, we feel the wind of your spirit, and the heartbeat of heaven, let us.